Welcome. This is another episode of The Tracker on Citi TV. Today on the show, we shall have a very interesting conversation with a very, very special guest. So don't change your dial. Stick around. We will take the motivational video when we come out, introduce the guest, and then we get the show on the road.
I was a kid with a dream, and I was a little kid that wasn't afraid to dream as big as I could.
You know, I said to myself, I'm going to do this and no one's going to stop me. You know, whatever you want to do in life is possible.
Those goals that I thought about every single day kept me coming week after week and year after year until I was able to accomplish them.
I think there were so many people who doubted things that I wanted, and I believe that I could achieve. You know, I believe that I could go into 2008 and be perfect. I believe that.
Making it look easy. He's going to tie the greatest Olympic champions of all time and do it in world record fashion.
Never give up. And I never have, and nobody ever should. If it was easy, everybody would be doing it. There are always going to be ups and downs, but I think it's really how you get back on your horse and keep going forward. People don't make excuses. Some of the best athletes or the greatest athletes in the world do things when they're uncomfortable. You know, everybody can compete when they're feeling good, happy, excited, rested. But it's the best people who can overcome when they're tired, sore, not in a great mind, you know, not in the best mindset. And I think mental power that the greatest athletes have can push all the pain aside. There were times where I've been put in uncomfortable situations, but I've used my mental power, my mental strength to push through it.
For me to become the person who I am today, I found myself in the darkest possible place that any human being could go. No matter what kind of mood I'm in, no matter how many hours of sleep I've had, no matter what, I know if I'm prepared, nothing else matters.
No hit at court seven. Here it comes. Come on, Gordon, come on.
You know, if you want to do something and you want it that bad, you'll make sacrifices.
I've had some ups and downs throughout my whole entire career, and if you asked me today if I would change it, I wouldn't. You have the combination of mental, physical, emotional toughness. If you have every one of those, that's what makes you great.
Welcome. This is The Tracker. So that motivational video was about how to achieve success, and great sportsmen were shown in that video. And those men are only great because they have people like my guest today always backing them. Mr. Nunoo Mensah is my guest today, president for the Ghana Olympic Committee. Without them, the athletes really can't do much. Uncle Ben is what everybody likes to call you.
I'm okay with Ben. Thank you.
Very good morning, and thank you very much for joining us here today.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much for having me. I think this is the second time I'm...
Yeah.
And I think for somebody in sport, that's not too good. I should have been here more frequently than I have done. But that notwithstanding, I think we've spoken on there a lot of times, and I've followed you guys and what you're doing to help Ghana sports. And I think that on behalf of all the youth that are doing sports that you guys are helping, I must say thank you very much. Yeah. And we really appreciate what Citi Sports is doing to push our sports up. And I'm very happy that I'm here with you today. Thank you very much.
It's our job, really. It's the little that we can do. I mean, this was supposed to be a big year for you, for the Olympic Games. 2020 was postponed because of COVID-19. I mean, how is it so different? Because I'm sure that before the start of the year 2020, you had been planning all along until 2020 hit. I mean, first week of 2020, first month, second month, things were going according to plan. Then, boom, all of a sudden, your entire year calendar ruined. I mean, what? How has that affected you? What have you been up to?
Well, thanks, Tahiru. I mean, it's like COVID has really affected every sector of our life.
Yeah.
It's not only about our sports. I think the one sector that has suffered much bigger impact is our economic life, which, you know, and once it's a global thing, I wouldn't say the effect on a country like Ghana is not huge, because it's not like the rest of the world is moving and then back home in Ghana we are stuck, then we can move. So it's a global problem. But that notwithstanding, I'm sure we'd all wish that we had gone ahead with all the plans that we have in the first half of 2020, but it never materialized. Mm-hmm. But like I said, it's a global thing, so we're not losing that much. For me, I've always said that I think that COVID is once, it's as much as it's not a curse to us, it also comes with a bit of blessing.
Yeah.
You know, out of the bad situation in COVID, we should try and find some bit of blessing. And I'm saying that because if we had gone to the Olympics this year, I'm sure our athletes would not have been prepared very well to take on the rest of the world. Okay, the postponement of the Olympics because of the COVID gives us 12 months to right the wrongs that we have done. You know, as a nation, we over-focus on just one sport, and we think that it is just that one sport that when we have to go to a tournament, the states or the nation has to put in so much to prepare the athletes.
Yeah.
And then we lose sight of the other disciplines that most often than not, they bring us glory when they go out there.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think that with the 12 extra months that we have, we should now refocus and invest a little bit in athletes, especially those who have qualified for the Olympics, and then those who are on the verge of qualifying. We currently have just about five athletes who have qualified. In fact, there are a lot of qualifiers that couldn't happen before COVID came. And I know the international federations are trying to refix that. Once that is done, then Ghana can have the full complement of our team to the Olympics. So it's both a curse and then a blessing.
And
I think that so far it hasn't been that bad. We're just making do what we have.
I mean, you mentioned the athletes who have qualified. I know two boxers have qualified, two track and field track athletes and have also qualified. Yeah, I don't know who the fifth
athlete.
And
then there's a para
athlete who has also qualified.
Exactly. Just
five athletes had qualified by March, which was just about 3 months to the start of the Olympic Games.
Yeah.
By the average of our qualification numbers, how confident were you that we were going to get a significant number representing in Tokyo?
Tahiru, I think that the problem that we have in this nation is that we always wait to the very last minute and then we want to do things, and which is not good for a nation that wants to develop.
Yeah.
Most of our sporting discipline had a chance to have gone through their qualifiers way in early 2018. We could have sealed most of the qualifiers. But the challenge they had was that, you know, most of them didn't have money to even go for these qualifiers, you know, until GOC came in with some money that we got from ANOCA and then started distributing to the individual federations. That is what enabled them to even go out for qualifiers. If you remember the case of boxing, we virtually have to fund the trip to Senegal to secure those two slots. We spent close to $20,000 on the boxers, pay for their accommodation, their tickets, etc., just for them to, you know. So if we had been up with our act, I'm sure before 2019 would have gotten qualifications, you know. So that's the kind of problems I'm telling.
That we are facing.
If we don't step up and do things right, we'd always have these challenges. The other problem was that most of the international federations, well, hadn't then fixed their last qualifiers, which of course were waiting for the last minute, as Ghana always do. So I think that we should be learning lessons from these challenges and do things better the next time.
I mean, you came into office in 2017. Obviously, so for that Olympic cycle, the last Olympic Games had ended in Rio in 2016. Did you have a target for yourself in terms of how many athletes that you wanted to go? Because everybody agreed that something needed to change. And I've got numbers here that are not pleasing at all to our ears. If you look at, since 1984, we've sent 196 athletes to the Olympic Games since 1984.
Yeah, exactly.
And since then, it's been what? About what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 different Olympic Games, and we've only been able to send 196. Yeah. 2008, 9 athletes. 2012, 9 athletes. 2016, 14 athletes. These are appalling numbers in terms of even representation, not to talk about winning medals. Did you have a target for yourself about how many athletes you wanted to take to the Olympic Games in Tokyo 2020? And by the average of 5 that we had, 3 months to go, were you getting close to hitting your target?
Well, you know, you always want to see progress in your life.
Yeah.
So if for the last Olympics we took 3 athletes, then it's fair and proper that for the next one we need to take 4. Okay, so all that we had planned as a GOC was that if the last Olympics in Rio we had 9 athletes or we had 12 athletes, then at least let's try and add 1 more athlete. Mm. You know, then we can see that as a nation we're getting better. It's better than our numbers dwindling down. But as much as we want to do that, the problems or the challenges or the things that hold us back, the things that don't make us increase our numbers, always also keeps increasing. I mean, some years back, maybe 4 years ago, we could have gotten or we had the opportunity to go to a lot of qualifiers for virtually all our disciplines. Mm-hmm. Look, swimming qualified for the Olympics. Judo was there because they had a chance or they had money to go through qualifiers. Okay, what is going to happen this year? Abeku has to go to Paris for the last qualifiers. If he's unable to pull through, that's fine. Weightlifting, we have on the verge of qualifying 2. They're almost there.
Yep.
You know, if they also pull through, that's fine. And then judo is likely to have one person more. Okay.
Boxers still have a chance.
Boxers also have one more. You know, even if we go with the same numbers that we went with Rio,
that is 14.
That is huge success because the challenges, like I said, is rather multiplying. Instead of us getting better as a nation in the way we approach these games,
yeah,
we are getting worse. You know, so I always say that, look, if you want to do sports, we need to invest in it, put money in it. I mean, look, people spend 4 years to prepare for the Olympics.
Yep.
We spend 4 months. And then we put all the athletes together and say we're taking them to a pre-games. It doesn't work that way.
Yeah.
You know, so my brother, as a nation, we all to be blamed. It's not only the ministry or the administrators, but all of us, myself, yeah, the media, everybody involved.
I'm what sure you knew the problems before you came in.
Yeah.
In the 4 years, or let's say 3.5 years kind of that you've been in power, what specific measures have you put in place in trying to address or trying to see success in the midst of all of the problems
exactly
that we have?
Exactly. You know, before the current GOC administration came, there was virtually, you know, no direct relationship between the national federations and the NOC.
Okay.
What we have tried to do is that at least every year, we support the national federations with some funding. I mean, the last one was what enabled most of them to go for the qualifiers. We virtually supported or gave money to every national federation who had to go for the qualifiers. It would have even been a challenge if we hadn't been able to access that money from ANOCA. You know, fortunately, because of the good relationship we have with ANOCA, they gave us the $90,000, which we even gave some to the football team, which at that 8,000. Time people felt it was in, you know, rugby or
do you have I do have a list of how you distributed the money. I find some names missing. I'm interested. Yes. So you got $90,000 from the Association of National Olympic Committees.
Exactly.
To support athletes who are trying to qualify for the Olympic Games.
Exactly.
So you brought this 90,000 back to distribute to what, 36 federations?
No, it was only for federations that had were going for qualifiers. For instance, we supported badminton, we supported taekwondo with about 9,000, weightlifting about 7,000.
Let me just help you with the list I have here.
Okay.
So rugby, football, boxing.
Exactly.
All got 8,000 cities.
Boxing,
each.
Eventually, we had to spend a little bit more money.
Oh,
you know,
so
when
you
they got there, we had to
that.
Go and pay 6,000 for the accommodation. We had to pay some monies that they were owing. So eventually, it was close to $20,000.
Cycling, badminton, swimming, and fencing, 5,000 each.
Exactly.
Taekwondo, shooting, 3,000 each.
No, taekwondo got 5,000 in addition to the earlier 3,000.
So that's 7,000.
Okay.
Weightlifting, 7,000.
Yeah.
So that will come up to what?
Karate do also got some money. I mean, if I can get those the exact figures,
you know,
for you.
And it's very interesting that you mentioned it, because conspicuously missing in the list is athletics. What's happening there? Because you look at our history at competitions, even from the recent African Games, it's always athletics that's always winning
majority of the
medals.
Exactly.
You've got money to support some athletes or federations to try and qualify for the Olympic Games. Shouldn't you be looking at the federation that has consistently been representing the country? Why is athletics missing?
Athletics were given the highest amount. I think athletics was apportioned 10,000 of the. But unfortunately, athletics hasn't assessed it. But athletics, you know, we have a distribution list. Yeah. Everybody, the top, anytime we're doing something, the top of our national federation is track and field.
Yeah.
Because they have the numbers also. And, you know, and they were looking that they could they would qualify as many athletes as possible, you know, and so that has been allocated to track and field. Maybe one of their qualifiers they want to assess, but it's been allocated.
And why haven't they assessed yet?
I don't know. They haven't come asking. I'll need to either find out from the treasurer or the secretary general. But we have the distribution list. Yeah. We have there. It was all allocated to all the federations. And like I said earlier, athletics was top. I think they got the highest amount.
Yeah, because and I'm asking because the athletics qualifying series started way back 2019, just like football.
Exactly.
If football got their money in November 2019 while they were going to participate in the competition in Egypt, which was eventually unsuccessful, you've got athletes who have been participating from the African Games all the way to the World Championship. All of those events constituted qualifying series for the Olympic Games. Isn't it strange that they haven't come asking for the money? Or
I don't know.
Am I missing something?
I don't know. You may have to find out from them, you know, because we actually allocated money for track and field. I mean, track and field is our top federation.
Yeah.
I mean, whichever way you look at it, you know. So yes, there's the money was allocated for track and field. Let me see if I can pull up WhatsApp on what the secretary general did and allocation. No.
Yeah.
Track and field was factored. I think they got the highest.
Okay. All right. What we will do is that I want us to talk about Ghana at the Olympics and what our performances have been over the years and what our plan is going forward to try and win more medals or try to change the narrative and try to make us a country that is worthy of conversation when the Olympics is talked about. I'm sure ultimately that's your dream. But first off, we'll have this report for you that we put together in 2018. And this was 2 years to the Olympic Games, and we were basically asking the question of this. There's Operation Win Medals in 2020. It's 2 years to the Games. Where do we stand?
Yeah.
And then we'll come back and talk about the 2 years after this report has aired. So you take a look at this. Team Ghana's participation at the Rio 2016 Olympics was heralded the personal best Olympics. It was supposed to be the competition that would offer the country's budding talents the opportunity to field the competition in readiness to take over the world in Tokyo 2020. On the surface, it made sense. Six of Ghana's 14-member contingent were below age 16. Experienced athletes like sprinter Jeanette Amponsa and middle-distance runner Alex Amankwa looked like they would be at their peak by the time 2020 came around. Sports ministers, both past and present, bought into the mantra, Operation Win Medals in 2020. But 2 years after Rio 2016, and 2 years to Tokyo 2020, officials have not put their money where their mouth is. The infrastructure support for athletes is virtually non-existent. The Elwak Stadium, the only national facility to feature tartan running tracks in Accra, is in a sorry state. The old tracks, tired from the overuse, have now begun to peel off. This is the state of the tartan tracks at the Elwak Sports Stadium, the only running track available in the whole of the Greater Accra region. And it's basically made of potholes. Have a look at this. And all of this, it's only a matter of time because all this completely peels off. And there's many more like this across the country. Low-class facilities that we expect our athletes to train on and win medals at the global stage. Are we giving them the best possible competitive advantage by providing them these sort of facilities to train on? I think not. Nadia Ike, African triple jump champion from Durban in 2016, is one of those the country is banking hopes on to win medals in 2020. But she says facilities in the country, such as the Elwak Sports Stadium, has made it impossible for her to progress.
I mean, honestly, the way it is here, it's almost impossible to train. And so everyone always says, oh, if you want to compete for Ghana, you know, why? I've actually, on my Facebook page, a lot of people always make comments like things like that, like, why is it that our own athletes are not training at home and stuff? It's because we don't have the facilities to do so.
New athletes have emerged since Rio 2016 to become potential medalists in Tokyo. 19-year-old Ho Halutie's performance at the Commonwealth Games and the African Championships has everyone excited about her future. But the country has been here before. Budding talents emerge, giving the country glimpses of glorious future. Then they fade off without a trace. Martha Bisa is a classic example. For General Secretary of the Ghana Athletics Association, Bawa Fuseni, the margin between talent and result lies in adequate investment in preparations.
But all these things cannot materialize if we as a nation do not prepare these athletes very well. They can always qualify on their own, but the preparation towards this competition is always the challenge. So if we want, as the state wants to win a medal at this Olympic Games in Tokyo, then we have to put more resources into the athletes so that they're able to prepare adequately for that.
Since Ghana made its Olympics debut in Helsinki, Finland in 1952, the country has racked up 14 appearances at a global multi-sport event. Team Ghana has sent over 1,400 athletes to the Games since that time and have only 3 bronze medals to show for it. The Ghana Olympic Committee President, Nunoo Mensah, is crying out for investment, the only way he believes the country can turn around its abysmal performances at the Games.
So from now to 2023, I think that as a people, as a country, we need to start investing in you. And when I say investing in you, making it possible for you to go to as many training or as many competitions as possible, helping you with your scholarship programs, helping with your educational program, and making sure that you're being taken good care by doctors and physiotherapists, and then you focus on your training.
While all facilities desperately need renovation, government has launched an ambitious sports infrastructure project, commencing the construction of 10 multi-purpose youth resource centers across the country. They're expected to be completed in December 2018. And for Sports Minister Isaac Essiema, that is the solution to the country's Olympic woes.
Well, the fact of the matter is that Ghana doesn't have enough sporting facilities. Travel across the world, you will see countries. Wherever you go, simple sporting, decent ones are there. We don't have enough. We need to do more to get more sporting facilities. Because you see, over the years, if sports has declined in this country, it's because of this. We are building, we are destroying all the spaces we have for sports. This is a time for us to obviously secure the future of sports through this investment.
With barely 2 years to the Games in Tokyo, the plan to win medals appears a shaky one, if there was any plan at all. For now, we can only stay cautiously optimistic that medals would actually be won, although history tells us another monumental failure awaits the country if what officials have done in the last 2 years is what they intend to replicate in the remaining two leading to the Games. Wow. So that report was put together by the Citi Sports team, of course, from 2018. So that was 2 years ago. So since then, what has happened to our plan for Operation Win Medals in Tokyo 2020? The GOC president is here. He's been cheering on that particular report. But what we'll do is take a short break. When we come back, we'll delve into our plan to win medals in Tokyo 2020. Stay with us.
Have you heard of Wheel of Fortune?
No, what's that?
Register on betplanet.com.gh. Uh-huh. Select Wheel of Fortune and right. Win a prize.
What? Wait, I'm just going to win a prize because I'm new?
Yes, but to win a prize, you only deposit 10 Ghana Cedi.
Before I win, I have to pay?
Really? So you're comparing 10 Ghana Cedi to an iPhone, an iPad, 25,000 Ghana Cedi? Eh? Utu mi a drink, papa. Uye pepe.
Okay,
then spin. Babe, we are ready!
Precision. Style. Class. Execution. Talent. Congratulations to the top 20 contestants that made it to the main audition for Keyboard Idol. The question is, which of these 20 talents will be in the top 10 and ultimately become the Keyboard Idol? Catch the Keyboard Idol every Saturday at 7 p.m. only on Citi TV. Tune in to Citi TV and follow the conversation using the hashtag Keyboard Idol for updates or visit cititvonline.com. This amazing talent competition is sponsored by Asanka, powered by TechAid and Santol Energy. Keyboard Idol is powered by Citi TV. The quest to find a keyboard superstar starts now.
Watching the tracker live on Citi TV. My name is Fentuo Tahiru. I'm in a conversation with the Ghana Olympic Committee President, Mr. Ben Nunoo Mensah. So if you just joined us, we had a report earlier from 2 years ago talking about Ghana's plan to win medals in Tokyo 2020. And that conversation was born out of Ghana's participation at the Rio 2016 Olympic Games, where as many as six of their 14 athletes were under the age of 16, and the hope was that they would peak by the time Tokyo 2020 came around. Now, it's even been extended by another year. We're going to Tokyo 2021. Mr. Ben Nunoo Mensah, is it possible for us to win a medal at Tokyo 2021?
Tahiru, I need to be very objective. I need to be real and be realistic.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no way we can win a medal in Tokyo 2020. But as they always say, in sports, anything could happen. I mean, we have a weightlifter who was qualified for the Olympics, and then you have all the people ahead of him dropping their weights, and then he could, by virtue of that. But if we're going to win medal by way of performing fairly with everybody, it'll be very difficult. It'll be extremely difficult, you know. So that should tell us that there's something we're not doing right. I think the last time we won a medal at the Olympics was way back in 1992 when it was a meteor. So, okay. And since then, we haven't won a medal at the Olympics. And we don't look like winning a medal in Tokyo. Yeah. What we should be looking at is doing better than what we did in Rio. I mean, that is the only way we can see as a nation we are progressing. But from where I sit, it's also becoming even more difficult for us to do better than we did in Rio. in terms of performance by our
even in terms of athletes. Qualifiers.
Exactly, exactly.
Because we took 14. So far, exactly. We are only 5.
Yeah. And, you know, but sorry, let me say, it was an excellent report you guys Thank put you. Together. I know there's a lot of brain work working into yeah. doing that. And I like the bits that the minister came in with infrastructure. My argument with the minister and the technical advisor have always been that, look, yes, it's good to invest in infrastructure, but we need to, at the same time, be investing in the athletes as well. You know, because if we say we're going to sit back, invest in infrastructure for 2 years, and then now we start investing in the athletes, we'd have lost a lot of ground.
Yeah.
So as much as we're putting so much money, which I must congratulate the minister for, I mean, if previously we had been putting these resource centers, at least areas where athletes can go and train, I'm sure would have been better as a nation. So that is a good thing that the Honorable Minister has started. But I think that we need to complement that by now consciously investing in our athletes. And when we say investing in our athletes, we mean give them the opportunity to go to as many international competitions as possible.
Yep.
Let's make sure that when they go for these competitions, they are very well taken care of. Because for the so-called least finance sports, Tahir, when we travel, most of the time, it's the federation themselves or the president of the federation funds it. I mean, look, track and field was in Doha. What did we as a nation put in? Weightlifting, we've been going all over the continent to do our qualifiers. You know, we only come up or live up as a country when it has to be football.
Mm.
But you see, just like football has to go through so many qualifiers to get to the African nations, all the other disciplines have to go through the qualifiers. So why don't you put them in the 5-star hotel like we put our footballers? Why don't you pay them the kind of per diems that we pay our footballers? Then we have every moral right to ask them to go to Tokyo and come back with medals. But if you don't invest in me, and then you turn around and say, hey, you know, please, that's too much. We did not invest in that athlete. What give us the moral right to ask him to come back with a medal for the nation?
Yeah,
but that notwithstanding, exactly.
Expected.
But that notwithstanding, tell you, look at our performance, especially on the continent, over the last, 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
Look at the African Games. Which disciplines brought medals to the country?
Mm-hmm.
Track and field, weightlifting.
Yep.
You can say that the year before and the year before. Okay, football is our passion. For instance, I come from a football background. My sports administration started with football, with ARAS.
Right.
But that is okay. It doesn't mean that we should develop football at the detriment of developing the other sports, more especially when these little sports, with nil investment, zero investment, they go out to international championships and they're able to fly our flag and win medals. They win gold medals for us. I mean, I saw Haluti on the clip. Since the African Games, what have we as a nation put in their training? What have we as a nation put in all those wonderful weightlifters who won gold medals, silver medals? What have we done? Nothing.
Even the relay squad, nobody
Nothing.
Knows where they
you know,
are now.
And this is a squad that won gold. If we put a little bit of investment, and you know, they don't need the kind of money that we probably put in a football team. They probably need just about 1% of what we put in a football team. But yet still, they don't get it. You know, so we need to rethink as a nation.
I mean, it's a deep-rooted problem.
Yeah.
Funding of federations and participation or even, you know, sponsorship of athletes to train and all of those things. But beyond what the state isn't doing, I know that the International Olympic Committee has got their own systems and measures in place that ensures that athletes are able, are getting funding
exactly.
to support their qualification exactly. process. Talk to me about the Olympic scholarship and yeah. how many of our athletes are benefiting from this Olympic yeah. scholarship and, you know, how we can try to expand those numbers.
Yeah, okay. What we have done as GOC, like I keep saying that we can do everything. The responsibility of the national teams rests solely with the ministry. But what we have done is to make sure that our elite athletes, athletes who are performing very well, put them on an IOC scholarship. You know, based on your performance, once we send a report that, look, we have this particular athlete who has gone to 11 competitions and this is his performance, you know, then you have the chance of being put on the IOC scholarship. We currently have 12 athletes, 12 Ghanaian athletes, on that scholarship. There are six track and field. At least there are two weightlifters. There's a shooter. There's a judo cart, and then there's one other discipline that happened. You know, so currently, these are the athletes that the GOC is supporting financially. We are also preparing for the Winter Olympic Games. We currently are putting two of our winter sports athletes, that's Frimpong, that's Akwesi Frimpong, yeah, and then Carlos Mena on Olympic scholarship. What these scholarship does is that at least it gives them some funding, a monthly allowance that they can use part to go for international competitions. And then the good thing about this scholarship is that if you spend the money on air tickets, you know, and you eventually qualify for the Olympics, you then have the chance of having that money refunded back to you. So it's always be a win-win situation for the athlete, especially if you eventually end up qualifying. What we've also done at the African continental level is that ANOCA has located about $1 million that once we get the full complement of qualified athletes for the Olympics, every nation is going to get a certain amount of money, or every NOC is going to get a certain amount of money, which as a GOC, we still invest in those athletes and make sure that they are going for training camps, they are getting the best facilities, the best coaches. You know, that is going to come once we have the full complement of our qualified athletes. What we've also done in the past is to run coaching courses for our coaches and make sure that at least with the little exposure that they get outside, for instance, weightlifting coaches up to the task because of benefit of these international coaching courses that the GOC runs. And lately, for the past 3 years, we always also make sure that at least we are able to get some little funding for the national federations, especially if they have to go to the qualifiers. I mean, since I became president, every year we've either given money for them to go for qualifiers or we've paid for affiliation fees. You know, and these are monies that we get from our sponsors. Okay. You know, these are not monies that come from the IOC. So we're doing a little bit to make a difference in our performance. But the chunk of it, you know, has to come when the national team has to travel for this international competition. That is where we always have a challenge, and there's no money to do that.
Okay. Just one more question before we move on to talk about other things, because it's an important project that the Ghana Olympic Committee is embarking on in Amasaman, that I would like us to talk about, because it could really be the future and redefine the way we train or bring up our athletes. Let's talk about collaboration here. In terms of, you came into power in 2017 to replace Professor Dodu, who is still the president of the Ghana Athletics Association. What is your relationship like with him in terms of collaborating? And I'm asking this question as backup to our earlier conversation about the athletics not getting the needed funding or not accessing the funding. Do you still have a good relationship with him? And is perhaps athletics, are they, you know, being, in quote, punished for being run by the man that you defeated during the last elections?
No, why should it be so?
Yeah.
Look, I'm president of the Olympic Committee. Mm-hmm. Yes, elections come, and when elections are over, I mean, look, I'm running a very different GOC. Maybe you had known the GOC in the past where anytime there's a GOC election, it's like a coup d'etat.
Yeah.
Anything about the past president, I mean, when we took over from BT Baba, even at least we were on scholarship, we were all sacked. The staff at the GOC office were all kicked out because it's a different GOC now. I'm running a GOC that includes everybody. Mm. We have expanded GOC such that, look, not only the National Federation presidents, all of them have the chance of maybe becoming chef de missions or GM, but even for the media, we make sure that, look, for every program is a different media person, you know, unlike in the past when it was just. So, look, I'm president of Olympic Committee. Mm. I think I should leave above, you know, pettiness and people. And I try to involve it. Anybody wants to help, I reach out to everybody. Anybody wants to help, the person is very welcome. But if somebody doesn't want to help, I mean, you don't say, okay, because this particular person is not helping, then I'm not going to do what I have to do. I run an open administration. Everybody's involved.
Yeah.
So anybody who wants to come on board to help is very welcome. And I've shown that, look, the GOC board is made up of, you know, people from things. Who didn't maybe support or vote for me, but we're working fine.
Yeah.
Everybody knows my secretary general wasn't, you know, part of my team, but we're working fine. Look, the current my administrative secretary at the GOC was the administrative secretary of the past president.
Mm.
This doesn't happen in the GOC that I came to know. The Podogbe GOC, the BT Baba, it was like, it's always like a coup d'etat. So I have moved on from, you know, that pettiness.
So, again, my question, what's your... So you have a good professional relationship with Professor Dodu. He's the president of a federation.
Exactly, exactly.
Yeah. You mentioned something that I'd like to touch on briefly, the all-inclusive GOC that you run, and the fact that a lot of the employees from the previous GOC administration still work at the GOC, even though you're now in charge and new executives are now in charge. But there's one peculiar case that's being all over the media to do with one former GOC employee, Erasmus Kwao. He sued you for unlawful termination. Is that not in contradiction to what you said earlier about running an all-inclusive federation, or his case is a little bit unique?
Tahiru, I'm sure everybody knows that when people want to play mischief, they can play to whatever level they want to. Okay, I took over the Ghana Olympic Committee in March. Okay, the young man's employment with the GOC, I think, was terminated about 6 months or 8 months down there, when we had sat down properly and at board level and assess what we need and what we don't need.
All right.
How we want to run the GOC and come up with an organizational chart. Okay. We had an organizational chart. We just made room for one project officer. Okay. Unfortunately, we can't have two. And then the role that one of them was playing is a role that has been taken up and freely by a subcommittee, you know, like putting things in the media and just creating websites and stuff like that, was being done by a subcommittee at no cost to the GOC. The GOC doesn't have the kind of money. Every year, we only get about $45,000 to pay salaries, to pay our administrative bill and all these things. We needed to be prudent and make sure that that money that comes is being used judiciously. So if, as a body, we can get, you know, people do things voluntary. And Olympicism is all about voluntary. For instance, nobody pays any board member of the GOC to be part of the GOC.
Yeah.
You know, we don't get paid. You know, so that was done after a careful look at our operations and then try to stretch out the best way to use the little money that comes to that. You know, so I don't like no, at all. But I don't like when people know the truth and they play mischief with these things. I think that for me, and I'm saying this because you only ask, but a lot of the things that has been said, and you know, he's done, and this didn't start.
A lot has been said.
And this didn't start from now. I mean, he's been all over. He's been sending me emails and sorting.
Wow.
You know, it's. And I'm the president of Ghana Olympic Committee, for Christ's sake. I won't come that low and say, look, this is because I have a personal. No, if I did, or if I behave like my predecessor had done. I mean, you take over and everybody was asked to go. You know, every single staff was asked to go. There were 7 staff at the GOC. They were all sacked. I don't want to talk about these things.
Yeah.
There were people on Olympic scholarship, which had been approved by BT Baba. Their scholarship were all withdrawn. Media people didn't have the chance to even have the opportunity of also being part of Team Ghana. It was, please, we have opened GOC up and people should stop playing mischief. Let's look at what is in the best interest of every. If now GOP is open to the saying that at least 7 media people have had the chance of traveling with Team Ghana, is it not better than just limiting it to one person who always go and come? Please, I beg you. Absolutely. I'm only saying this, and I'm not going to talk about this because it's just pure mischief.
Okay.
There's so many things that have been said.
Okay.
That just
Let's talk about what is not mischief, and this is great. The Olympic Solidarity Project or the juvenile center that you're putting up, that the Ghana Olympic Committee is putting up at Amasamai. Not a lot of people seem to know about this project. Talk to us about it, because I'm under the impression that this could be a landmark project that could really start the development of sports from the grassroots level.
Yeah, exactly. Tahiru, when we took over in the 2017, it was one of the things that we had said that we were going to do a bit of focus on, because Amasama land was assigned from the Ministry of Agri to the then GOC president, Mr. B.T. Baba, about 15 years before we took off. What IOC did was to fund the project. So they had sent down some money, and they were hoping that that money could be used to put up infrastructures on the field. But, you know, because of our land tenure system here, when you get a piece of land and you don't wall it, I mean, you have people encroaching. And I'm saying this with hindsight that, look, if Honorable B.T. Baba hadn't walled Amasama, Tahiru, there will never be any land for me and you to be talking about now. Yes. And
it was, you know, being badly encroached.
It would have been taken over. But you see, it's been walled. It's just, it's as big as a Accra Sports Stadium.
Oh, wow.
And the wall is as high as Accra Sports Stadium. So it became very difficult for anybody to encroach. And I'm saying this more especially when in the last few months, I've been involved in trying to regularize the papers on Amasama.
Okay.
And I said to myself, if Honorable Baba hadn't walled it, look, there would not be anything to talk about. So when I came, the place had almost become like a forest. So we were able to put some money together from sponsors, including my own company. And we got a bulldozer. We went in there, brought down all the trees and cleared the place, you know. And then subsequently, what we did was that to create a football field there. We also created a volleyball, two volleyball pitches and a netball pitch there. And then together with the Ghanot Assembly and the East Metropolitan Assembly, we've been encouraging the schools to have the activities there.
To the extent that
now, it's just to keep the place lively. Now, it is a community park, even though it doesn't have the kind of first class facilities that you talk about.
Right.
But at least the children have a place where, when they have their inter-district competitions, you know, they all go there. And then, and for racetrack, what they do is that they take Carlo and then, you know, they mark the racetrack. It's exciting.
What's the ultimate plan for the project?
I'm coming to that. You know, the initial investment was from the IOC. The IOC at a point in time has said, look, we need to regularize the document on the land. Then they can further invest there. The Olympia Africa Center also came down somewhere last year. They've also promised to put up a tennis court there, but they're also waiting for that document. And fortunately for us, there's something big going to happen in Amasama. I would want to announce it together with the other stakeholders who have been working behind the scenes to secure this project. So I don't want to break the news here.
Yeah.
We'll wait, and then during the press conference, hopefully maybe in the next 2 weeks or 3 weeks, we should be able to come together with all the other stakeholders.
What will we have there?
Ah, Tahiru, now you're pushing me. I can only tell you what we have there now. I told you have a Sakura field, which the community plays soccer there. We have a volleyball, two volleyball pitches there, and a netball.
Ultimately,
and then, of course,
to have these facilities in a professional manner.
Exactly.
So a professional football pitch, volleyball.
Exactly. You know, and one thing that I always want to correct people, Amasaman, or now they say it's Afiaman. Sorry, we've been in a lot of war, even with the original landowners. What we are doing at Amasaman is not going to be an elite stadium.
Right.
It is supposed to be a facility where our youth can go and develop their talent.
Okay.
So it's that's why we call it a youth excellence center, juvenile excellence center.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it will be facilities for the youth. What we're looking at having there, which of course our elite can at least can use, is the camping base that we intend to put up there.
Yeah.
Where if maybe boxing have to go for a tournament, they want a place to come, they can go there. If weightlifting have to go, you know. But the facilities will focus mainly on the youth athletes within the catchment area. So it would be a facility where you can go and develop your talent as a youth athlete. And then once you become an elite athlete, you can look at the other.
Short one. Do you have timelines for completion?
Unfortunately, money dictates what you do. If we had some money sitting in a bank somewhere, in a vault somewhere, and then I can just go pick and then do, then I can give you very firm timeline. But what I can tell you is that at least from a forest that it was when we took over, now at least it's a community park where the community can go and play.
She made that point.
We're looking at by the end of December, we'll have something that is, but I'm, like I said, I want to wait till we do the press conference. And then
we don't have a lot of time left, but if I don't touch on this, everybody would say, why did you not touch on it? The Commonwealth Games matter. The visa scandal, it was big news in the country. Lots of people got suspended. Your office, the GOC, instituted a disciplinary grievances and dispute resolution committee. The Amadi Tango, now a Supreme Court justice, he chaired that particular committee. Lots of witnesses were called. I've read the report myself. And I'm interested in the recommendations and how far you've gone with implementation of those recommendations. If you go to chapter 31, page 142, the findings of the committee, quite a lot of findings against several members of your administration. You personally was not indicted, and no recommendation was made for your removal from office, obviously. But your first vice president, Paul Acho, the volleyball president, there was recommendation for his removal. Has that happened?
Tahir, even before you said that, let me put things in context. And I'm also surprised that 2 years down the line, we're still talking about a media-created who brought about Commonwealth Games. The people who were detained at the airport, or people who were returned, the 11 journalists, and that's on record, the 11 journalists who were returned, did not get the accreditation through the GOC. Just like you know, when there's international games, journalist accreditation are done by themselves online. Mm. Nobody went through on the GOC or through the GOC. Every person that was arrested there probably did whatever he has to do with his media house. The GOC was not involved. And I think that I keep explaining this thing, okay? Yeah. What the GOC tried to investigate, which we then have a standing committee to, is infractions on administrative processes by people who are members of the GOC.
Which is what I'm asking about. Yeah.
Which did not create any problem because those infractions were curtailed by the chef de mission going to Australia and then making sure that he has Team Ghana list. It probably you heard that a member of Team Ghana, or the list that Mohamed Sanu submitted to the Commonwealth Games, somebody has been detained on that. Then you have a case against the GOC. But in putting together those lists, there were people who had interested and said, oh, look, put this one there, put this one there. You know, those things were able to discover. And then we put measures in place that those people could not travel to Australia.
Yeah.
But of course, when we came back as responsible leaders, now let's look at those who try to abuse our system, yeah, even though they were not successful. And that is
what I'm interested
our,
in.
Our dispute and resolution committee, we tasked them to do. They did a report, we presented it to Congress, Congress voted on it, and the measures that they had recommended were all taken up as per what Congress had voted. They may have made recommendations based on whatever, you know,
So what I just do is just you tell me briefly if the recommendations, the following recommendations were accepted at Congress or voted against. The committee recommended the removal of Paul Acho, first vice president of the GOC, the Volleyball Federation president. Has he been removed?
I think it was, you know, when committees do their report, is it up to Congress to accept it?
Yes.
Or we do? No. Congress voted against it.
So he's still okay. Yeah. Evans, but what Congress, vice president.
But what Congress actually did was to withdraw Acho as a chef de mission for Tokyo.
For Tokyo,
and that has been done.
Okay. The report said that there was a lapse in due process between Evans Yabo and yourself because he was dealing directly with the IGC, the National Games Committee, and wasn't involving you. And the committee recommended that there has going forward, there has to be better liaison between you and all of your other, you know,
between the chef de Michel.
Yes. Yeah. Is that something that is happening now, that, you know, that communication gap is now being fixed and everything goes to you?
Exactly. Not through me. I think through the chef de mission. You see, once we appoint a chef de mission, anybody who wants to deal with any other person doing entries on behalf of the chef de mission, you should tell the it has to go through the chef de mission. You don't have to deal directly, you know, with those doing the entries. And that's where I think that the report is talking about it. Maybe he dealt directly, you know, not that with those doing the entries, instead of, you know, going through Mohamed Sanu.
What happened to the swimming president, Theo Eze?
Well, Theo was eventually removed from the GOC, and Theo has filed a petition, which we're waiting to hear on it, because he thinks that his removal was not constitutional. You know, so these things, the law, sometimes the law applies. Like, Congress has to accept the report. So there's nothing much you as an individual can do. It's up to Congress.
Yeah. You know. All right. So. Mr. Nunoo Mensah, it's been a pleasure. Wonderful conversation. I've learned a lot. And my eyes have been opened to quite a lot that I didn't know before. Thank you very much for joining us here on the Tracker this morning. My name is Fentuo Tahiru. Fentuo, thank you very much from wherever you're tuning. Until next time, take care of yourself and bye-bye.